Hello, everybody. My name is Karen. I work for CGI Estonia. I've got this very fancy title called Director of Business Development, which essentially obviously means that I make sure that CGI has stuff to build and stuff to test. I'm talking today about burnout. You've had a very long conference of tech stuff, so now a softer topic as well. I'm also acutely aware that after 3 days of tech talks, it's Friday evening and it's really sunny outside in Tallinn, which is a very rare occasion for us, usually in June and prior to midsummer. So I won't gab for an hour. I'll you know, make it a bit shorter, and then you can ask questions in the end as well. Right, how many people in the audience feel that we've become more busy in the last 5 to 10 years? Yeah? Wow, quite a lot of us. I've got this friend, and every single time I phone her, we know each other for about 15 years, and I ask, how have you been? And her response every single time, without fail, is busy. It's been a really busy week. I'm busy. Busy month, busy year. And I always wonder, do you really want to, you know, do you not want to speak to me? Or are you genuinely busy? Or are you just a busy body? Meaning, are you creating stuff for yourself to do that doesn't really need to be, you know, done? And on Tuesday, I was listening to the, I like to listen to the radio, and I was listening to the weather forecast, and the guy in the end of it says, have a busy day. And I thought, what? It's the warmest June in 10 years. You're telling Estonians to go and have a busy day. Come on, give us a break. Right, and how many of us feel that we're working too much? You know, who has felt work-related stress? I have, for sure. Working too much and, yeah. Do you think it's different?
Yes.
Explain maybe briefly.
Mm-hmm. Because the dog sort of dictates where I can go, but stress is different.
Okay, so you don't think they're that correlated? Cool. They can be, absolutely. And according to the American Institute of Stress, and it wasn't set up after Trump came to power, although they're probably a lot busier nowadays, 80% of people say that they feel stress on the job, and then half of those people say they need professional help to actually handle then the stress and to be able to deal with their lives outside of work as well. What causes us to stress out? Again, AIS, American Institute of Stress, say that there's 4 main causes for stress. Workload, closely followed by people issues. It was Jean-Paul Sartre who said, hell is other people. It still holds true today. Work-life balance and job security. And I guess the last one, with automation and the way the workplace is changing, is becoming more of an issue. You know, will our jobs be obsolete in a year, 2 years, a decade, never? It's a bit of a worry. What has changed in the last 20 years for us to be so much more stressed out? Well, workplace has changed, right? So we can now work remotely, we can work from home, it might not end that well for some of us. We can do platform working, so we can have a job, and we can also earn extra money through Wolt or Uber or Taxify. We don't need to be you know, committed to this one employer. We also can work, be self-employed, offer our services. And a lot of people have started lifestyle businesses. So you don't really need to work for a company at all. You can just have your hobby, make enough money to sustain yourself comfortably and not go and do the corporate rat race or work, you know, 10, 20, 30 years in a job. When I was preparing for this talk, I calculated how much working life I have left in me, you know, given the longevity and how long, you know, when my pension kicks in and stuff. And it's more than 40 years, which is longer than I've been alive. And it's quite daunting to think that I've got another 40 years left to work. Do you want to do it? So that kind of, you know, gave me a bit of food for thought. But the point is, we've become a lot more mobile. We're not tied to the same employer. an iPhone. I've got one here. It's basically a mini office. You can take it anywhere with you and then just get your work done. And this brings me to this topic of autonomy. So we think we're autonomous in what we do and how we work. We set our own goals. We choose who we work for. And autonomy is also used by employers to brand themselves as a desirable place to work. Come and work for us. Within our team, you have so much autonomy to look after, you know, your workload. You can work from home. You're autonomous in your decision making. And we're expected to self-manage a lot more than maybe 10 or 20 years ago. So we have to self-manage our career rather than a company doing it for us and giving, you know, laying out the 10-year career plan. We have to self-manage our networks. We self-manage our well-being. We self-manage our qualifications even, instead of a nation state body or, like I said, an employer doing it for us. And that creates stress. But because we're in this autonomy bubble, we think that the stress doesn't affect us. So that therein lies the paradox. Mainstream media, you know, your Wired and co-founder, HBR, all these magazines of tech and management speak, they tell us that this self-managing worker is beneficial for the company, that they're beneficial to the client and especially themselves. But what's really taking place is that a lot of companies are outsourcing the risk to the employee through utilizing this sort of autonomy selling point. I'm just going to grab a drink. And I mean, the self-management aspect. Another term that's used for this is the entrepreneurial worker and the self-managing worker. And there's quite a lot of management literature that refers to it with different kinds of terms. But I thought self-management is the one that kind of ties in the whole theory quite nicely. And the hidden cost of this is that the workers who are the most driven and the most committed are the ones who really believe they're autonomous and take on more risk and more stress. And what ends up happening is that, you know, this comes back. So these are the areas that get affected through this self-managing me and then all the stress that it creates. We end up working more because we are worrying about, you know, like LinkedIn, you know, we're now managing our networks. We're expected to tell our employer, you know, when you're in charge of a team, what you're going to be doing, how you're going to be managing. We don't have a hierarchical structure anymore. Companies are a lot more egalitarian and spread out. And the risk is therefore more spread out and will fall on us as individuals. And that leads to the same thing we talked about earlier. Workload, people issues, work-life balance gets out of hand. And we worry about their job security as well. Self-management starts to blur boundaries as well. So when we're working for ourselves or we're working on multiple platforms or remotely, home and workspace get blurred, friends, colleagues, that kind of boundary gets blurred as well. And within that trend, there's a parallel one that's also emerged in which time poverty and being busy is seen as more important than committing time to all these soft things like well-being and family and friends. So remember the friend I phone and ask, oh, how are you doing? Do you want to meet up? And she always says, oh, I'm so busy. Well, she's very exhibitive of that particular trend where you keep yourself busy because it's prestigious now to be busy all the time. And what this creates is it's a self-perpetuating circle which creates more insecurity. So we worry about our careers, we worry about the changing workplace. Are we employable in 10, 20 years' time? You don't need just one degree, you probably need two or three. If you pivot your career 10, 20 years down the line, you'll need to get all those qualifications again. So we self-perpetuate this cycle by worrying, self-managing, doing all this extra stuff outside of work to then have a job and not worry. So it kind of ends up being in this closed circle again. The debate is obviously not new. What's happened instead is that researchers have taken the ongoing debate from the 90s and even beyond, before that time, and put it into this contemporary workplace that's more mobile, changing, and more insecure for us. Again, when I was reading all this research, I started to think about myself. I've got a four-month-old baby. She's walking somewhere around this hotel with my mom, so I could come here. And I did a keynote last week, and I'm doing one on Tuesday. I'm going back to work in 5 weeks. And the worry is that if I don't do all these extra things, will I be hireable? So this self-managing that I do outside of work, that I don't have to do, and that a lot of people here will do as well. You know, you'll be publishing, you might have a blog, you'll heavily invest in your skill set. You're here, you know, at Nordic Testing Days, enhancing your skill set, the tutorials. All of this will self, you know, it's just a self-perpetuating, stress-creating cycle. I was laughing at this LinkedIn thing as well, because we now have something called a profile. So instead of recruiters looking at your CV, what you've done, speaking to you, you now need to have this paragraph of 3 or 4 sentences that describes your key achievements and what you've done and how you're valuable to your future employer or as a self-employed person, rather than, you know, somebody being able to make it out themselves. I now want to talk about my own burnout story as well. Maybe some of you have heard it. I've relayed this at the Viljandi Inspirational Conference as well. And there are some colleagues of mine in the audience who've heard it before. But 3 years ago, I did this. I was working on Star Wars, Fast Furious, big Hollywood movies, and not in this region at all, but out in the Middle East. And how it started was I had a dream, like all young people do when they leave high school. And I wanted to work in the film industry or in European art house cinema. But I really wanted to work in film and television. So I took myself to Scotland to study film and TV. It was too theoretical. So I stayed in Scotland for 2 years and then transferred to London and finished my degrees there. Because it's such a... how do I say this? It's very desirable to work in film and TV. It's seen as a really funky place to work. It's very hard to get your foot in the door, and you have to do a lot of free work. So when I was studying in London, I was working in ICT. So I've always worked in ICT to pay for my studies, my living costs, etc. And then I used to do free gigs to be able to pay my rent and, you know, food and so forth. And I was offered unpaid internships. The best one was 6 months long, unpaid, in London, which means you would have to take out a loan to be able to sustain yourself. And quite a few of my friends did that. So they would go to a bank, and they have a product called graduate loan. So while you're gathering experience working for free, you pay back this loan to the bank to be able to live and work for free. It's just absolutely ridiculous. So I completely refused to do this. So it took me a bit longer to get into film and TV. After London, we were in Johannesburg for a bit. My husband nearly died. He was attacked in a McDonald's car park held at gunpoint. And he thought, we need to move to a safer place. Let's go to the Middle East. So so we moved to Dubai, as you have it. And there, finally, I thought, right, let's see if I can really work in film and TV here. And I took, well, I was lucky. I got a job with a production company in Dubai. A producer spotted me and then said, you know what? The Sheikh of Abu Dhabi wants a film commission because Dubai has one. You know, it's the same country, the UAE, but it's still separate sandboxes. So Abu Dhabi has a film commission. They did Mission Impossible 4. I now want my own film commission and I want to do big movies. So there we go. I was in Abu Dhabi setting up a film commission with two local colleagues, an American producer, and some small, you know, local people as well. And we pitched to Universal, Walt Disney, Columbia, multiple Indian production companies as well. So my job basically was to lie that we have a film industry here in Abu Dhabi, because obviously we didn't, because we were just trying to create one. And we shipped everybody in from Dubai, 150 kilometers away, presented them as the local crew, and shipped them back again. And the joke is, people on a Dubai visa couldn't work in Abu Dhabi, so... Anyway, that's the local politics for you. But the films we scored or managed to get to come to film in Abu Dhabi instead of going to Morocco or Egypt, where it's a lot cheaper, were Before These Two was a Top Gear episode, a horror film with Eric Bana called Deliver Us From Evil, and Star Wars 7, The Force Awakens, and then Fast Furious 7 as well. So whenever we managed to get a movie to come, I would then be shifted onto the production team to help the local, to basically get the film made. And I thought, wow, I've made it. I'm working on big Hollywood productions in the middle of the desert and the sun's shining and it's horrible. And I hated it. I absolutely hated working on it. Why? The film industry is a relentless business. So it's not like, Estonia is lovely and cozy and tiny and fluffy and so forth. Over there, it's a big machine, lots of money, big names. And usually when you come in and do a film, so most of Fast Furious was filmed out in Atlanta in a studio, but for the local stuff, they come with a small crew and then get a crew together locally and they do the production there. And... usually it's like this, you pick up pace, and during the shoot time it's mental, you're doing crazy hours, and then you wrap and it kind of goes back down into normal mode. On an advert, it's shorter, it's about a month, you know, this digit peak, and then you kind of wrap again. With Star Wars, it was like this from the very beginning, like top. It was crazy, it was really busy because we were 3 months behind schedule. So immediately everybody was working 6 day weeks and 7 day weeks as well. 12-hour day is normal. That's the contracted normal working day. The lady in finance who was working 9 to 5 got paid part-time because that was seen as a part-time rate. There you go. So consider yourselves lucky. So my daily timetable would be I'd wake up at 6, 6:20, leave the house, get a McDonald's breakfast on the motorway, drive 150 kilometers to the office. My record time is 53 minutes. But I did have 2 car crashes in a year and a half as well. Then you would stay in the office until you are allowed to leave, because the head of department is the person who gives you permission to leave. So earlier when I spoke about the changed workplace, you can just go home, you know, tell your boss on Skype, I'm not coming in today, not in Hollywood. You go and say, yes, are we finished? Can I go home now? And for a while I thought, is this unique to this person or this place, but it isn't. It happened on every movie I worked on. So you don't go home until head of department goes home, even if you've got absolutely no work to do. So and you don't have a lunch break, because film offices have something called craft service. So next to papers, pens, all the stationery stuff, you have a kitchen fully stocked with everything. And daily we would be delivered fresh food. And lunch break, production assistants go out, get food, and deliver it back to us. So you'd carry on working, basically. So I'd get home at 9, 10, 11, sometimes midnight, it depends. Often I didn't remember to drive back. It was just, you're knackered. The longest shift I ever put in was 54 hours straight. It was Ramadan. We were filming in the night, because that's when you can eat. And then we changed locations as well. And after working for such a solid block of time, the amount of stress hormones in your body just won't relent. So I was lying in bed for 2 hours thinking, when the hell is the sleep going to come? Because I've been awake for such a long time. I never want to do that again. 54 hours is way too long. And you can imagine that with this sort of schedule, people get really irritable in a film production office. And there's a bunch of egos there. So egos plus tired people plus everybody being irritable doesn't end that well. So people shout at each other, scream, they slam doors. And there's a hierarchy as well. So you're not allowed, it's like in a military, you're not allowed to go over the chain of command. You follow the chain of command up and it comes back down. So I couldn't speak to my boss's boss directly. It had to be kind of done through the right means as well, so that it adds extra frustration to the whole pot as well. I saw my family one day a week, really. And when we were doing 7-day weeks, then I didn't see them at all. And usually for a film shoot, you actually move into a hotel. And then when you're done, then you move back home. That's how intense it can get. And I now entered this, not substance abuse phase, but I'll talk about the burnout phases later on as well. Because we couldn't leave the office or your desk unless you went to eat or to pee, I started smoking so I could go outside and have some fresh air. So I'd get through a packet a day. Because you're so tired all the time, you get tiredness headaches, right? So I took 8 paracetamol a day, one after waking up, one before lunch, one in the afternoon, and one before going to bed so I could sleep. You start to overeat because you're tired all the time. So you're, you know, the free craft service, oh, Snickers, Milky Way, give me all these Mars bars. So you're eating through about, you know, 12, 14 of those a day as well, just because you're so tired all the time. And my daughter realized I'm only home in the middle of the night. So she woke up at 2 to 4 in the morning every day, every single night. So I'd get home at 10, you know, get changed, go to bed, sleep maybe 3 hours, then be awake with her for 2 hours, then sleep another 2 hours, and then go to the office, the 150-kilometer journey. And you can imagine what kind of toll this will, you know, start to take on a person emotionally and physically. Extended stress testing. Let's see when I break down, how quickly, what kind, you know, really, really not a good thing to do to yourself. Obviously, problems at home start to emerge as well, because you don't see your child, you don't see your husband, knackered all the time, smelly from sweat and cigarette smoke, getting fat because you're eating all the time and you don't get any time to rest. The trouble is, when you're working in an environment like this, I was thinking, but we're doing Star Wars. J.J. Abrams needs a sand border in the desert in 2 hours. I need to find one. And you just don't stop to think or take a pit stop. And I found the sand border. And then he said, I don't need one anymore. And you're like, oh God, an hour, you know, wasted. I got one from Red Bull. He really hoped he can do this gig, but bless him, it didn't work out. You know, Vin Diesel needed stuff shipped out before he comes out. We had 45 shipping containers worth of stuff to get, you know, shipped out. And everybody's mocking together because it's such a hard industry to get into. People who work in it are really driven. So they will work regardless of their health, regardless of how tired they are, because you have to pull together and get it done. The money involved is massive. So there was millions of dollars that we spent locally on getting sets designed, on, you know, getting people in, etc. Just for Star Wars, we had, during the shoot weeks, we had 600 people for a week's worth of filming. So you have to have this chain of command type system in place as well, because otherwise things just get out of hand. And right before we did start filming, I came to Estonia to drop my daughter off, because usually what I do on a film shoot is I'd move away from home, live in a hotel, and then move back. And the year before I'd done it, I dropped my daughter here. She was a year and a half old. I left her here with a nanny for 3 months at my mum and dad's house, and then picked her up again in the end of the summer after I'd done the first film, the Eric Bana one. And then when I arrived 3 years ago to do the Star Wars one, I didn't go back. I decided I can't go back to this. I'm just going to stay here. And I slept for 2 months and then decided, oh God, what am I going to do with my life now? Because I wanted so badly to work in the film industry. It took 10 years to achieve the goal. And then once I got it, I hated it. It was absolutely horrible. So burnout, obviously, is a massive issue for HR because people leave. I left the filming and they had to get somebody else in who knew the local infrastructure, knew the way things work over there and so forth. And it's usually the most committed and the best people who burn out. So, you know, the gradual descent into not having anything more left to give. So this is what it translates in terms of money, burnout and churn. 12 billion working days each year are lost to because of stress and depression. Also absenteeism across companies is growing. And money-wise, it's costing us 700 billion euros a year to the global economy. And depression and I mean, this burnout is not just exhaustion that sets in. What usually happens is you're too depleted to be socially active. And the more you put yourself under this extended stress, the more isolated you become. And loneliness is actually more harmful to our health than being obese or than alcohol. Or it's actually even worse than smoking as well. So being lonely is what ends up happening. Right, I'm going to get to that slide in a minute. We can't obviously turn back time, right? So the workplace has been changing in the last 20 years. We're working more flexibly, etc. But what we can do is change the debate around burnout and depression and stress. That's one of the reasons I went into such detail sharing my own burnout story as well. Because it's, and it took a while. The first year I was back here, I thought, I can't tell anybody that things went completely, excuse my friend, tits over ours. I hated working there. You know, I was this, ooh, Hollywood producer person. I hated it. What if people think I failed, right? So it puts you in a quite vulnerable position in trying to defend yourself. But in reality, health-wise, what's happened is I will go deaf in my left ear gradually. It's not fixable. The doctor said, you know, well, we won't do an operation yet. Get more deaf and then we'll put something in and see what happens. And I used to have constant vertigo as well. So I will now have to take medication to regulate my inner ear blood flow so I wouldn't feel vertigo all the time. I mean, doing 160 kilometers an hour from Abu Dhabi to Dubai in the middle of the night thinking, oh, bummer, I'm going to, you know, you feel weightless for a second. That really freaks you out. And I guess all of us here in the room will know somebody who is exhibiting signs of burnout or stress. Maybe we notice them in ourselves as well. And it's really important to take that time to properly consider, am I curing cancer or am I making Vin Diesel look good? You know, which one is more important to the global well-being and happiness? When I was reading, actually, prepping for this conference, I was reading about QA burnout specifically, and I came upon this really cute blog where a guy said that QA is a very thankless and heartbreaking job to do. I don't know if that's true or not, but he personally felt that giving out product that's not fully tested and that's not fully working to a client that's paid for it, it's just something that really wore him down. So he changes jobs every 3 years just because he can't handle it. And also clients don't want rotation often in teams because knowledge transfer translates to loss of time. Loss of time translates to loss of money, usually. But as team leads, we should really make sure that our team is fresh, rotated, that they're not burning out. All these signs are things that we really need to look out for in our teams. The kind of right now I want to talk a little bit about the anatomy of the burnout. So these are the three basic responses, the subconscious responses we exhibit: fight, flight, or freeze. So the year after I got back from Star Wars, I spent most of that going to a therapist, Helena Leiss. She's a clinical psychiatrist. And so some of the stuff I will be talking about now is the stuff that she taught me. And I will now pass that knowledge on to you guys. People who are very driven tend to work more and tend to work even when they are breaking down physically and mentally. So even if they're noticing the signs in themselves, they will carry on working. And these responses are what we exhibit when we're put under stress. And stress can be, there can be two kinds of stress, so positive stress and negative stress. Subconscious is our kind of inner autopilot, right? So when we're faced with a situation that we can't handle, these three kick in. Is it going to be a situation where I can fight? Do I need to flee? Or will I surrender? Because there's nothing I can do. And it's automatic. So very often we don't have control over how it operates and when it kicks in. So when we're in a position where we're under distress, we're fighting goals and workload we can't handle, the flight mechanism kicks in and we become distressed because of this. And all living organisms have this fight, flight, or freeze response mechanism. But as human beings, we are very unique in that we can apply consciousness and awareness at will. And that's something we should start practicing a lot more often, because a person who is more aware of his or her emotions and breakdown and well-being will have a more varied range of responses than just fight, flight, or freeze. The positive stress, however, is what activates this fight mechanism in us. So when we're faced with challenges that are interesting to us and that we can overcome, we will get an adrenaline rush, we become depleted, and we associate it with a high. So that's why when we're working on things that we can manage, we're, you know, achieving the goals we've set to ourselves, we get this high and we just keep going, basically. Oh yeah, you know, Vin Diesel doesn't like the locally labeled frappuccinos from Starbucks, let's ship stuff in. We can't, you know, fuel a helicopter because nobody's bothered to fill the tanks. Let's find the solution. And you do it, you take it, and you just keep going. But it's important to take a pit stop, because you can't, you know, imagine a Formula One car going round that circuit non-stop without tires or something of it breaking. So that's why these pit stops are necessary to take out every once in a while. And this brings me to the phases of burnout. So what I just described to you, honeymoon phase, is where we are exhibiting these positive stress behaviors. We're enjoying what we're doing. We are achieving our goals. We get the high and we carry on. And when this is managed properly, this is fine. Positive stress can be a good thing. Now, the fireworks phase, however, is the when we haven't taken a pit stop for a while and we become stressed and we start exhibiting what the psychology calls these compulsive consumerist behaviors, i.e. drinking a bit more, you know, at the end of the working day, I really need a glass of wine or two. I really want that cigarette, going shopping, and these kinds of behaviors. Phase three is when we get into chronic symptoms. So allergies that may have lied dormant for a while come back. Physical ailments start to plague you, you know. It's actually not too bad to be deaf in one ear, because I can sit all the boring people here and tell them, oh yeah, I can't hear, and then they won't speak to me for the rest of the night. You have to see positives in it. And I can see the chronic symptoms in my husband right now as well, bless him. All his joints are aching. And he's, you know, gradually working himself to death as well. So I'm trying to pull it out and showed him my slides today as well. And he's being skeptical, but hopefully it will work. Phase four is the crisis phase. So that's when you're feeling even more. You know, all these emotions are getting worse. You're not feeling good about yourself. Self-esteem is starting to suffer. Am I doing this well? Am I good enough? And the final phase, the ultimate one, is burnout, which is where some people collapse. You can't get out of bed. Some people experience suicidal thoughts. And this is a stage where you don't want anybody from your loved ones, colleagues, or yourself to end up in. Which is why it's very relevant to notice all of the warning signs beforehand. Journal of Clinical Psychology has researched that depression is primed by burnout and by this positive stress. So positive stress very easily can become distress or negative stress and lead us into depression. So it's a staggering number, actually, that burnout, you know, leading into depression. And depression, as we know, is a very hard condition to treat, requires medical intervention, it takes years to get out of it. A friend of mine, actually, who is British, he is currently only able to work in a charity shop 2 days a week because he has chronic pain. And he used to be a very well-to-do graphic designer, just worked on too many projects for too long, completely collapsed, spent a couple of months in hospital, and is unable to ever work on this high capacity again that he was previously able to. Also, when I was reading this, prepping for this speech, I read about stress testing. And apparently, another term used for it is torture testing. So people in my team weren't sure if that's something that's used every day or not. I don't know if anybody in the audience is somebody who uses torture testing. But I think it's quite vividly something that, you know, well describes burnout, you know, test to breaking point, make them suffer through every phase. It can be a total torture test. It's a quote I found that I thought I would like to share with you. I'm not going to read it off the slide because it's not cool. You can read it yourself. If people at the end can't read it, then can you read it? Right. People look for retreats for themselves in the country, by the coast, in the hills. But there's nowhere that a person can find a more peaceful and trouble-free retreat than in his own mind. So constantly give yourself this retreat and renew yourself. In the workplace, people, you know, we want to help our teammates. Deadlines are tight, often budgets are constrained as well, and we will say yes to these extra tasks and extra things that we're asked to do. Funnily enough, women are often the ones who bear the brunt of this because we are seen as the caretaking gender and the gender that's more easily available to say yes. You can accuse me of feminism. But my advice is to resist the urge. Just say no and leave yourself with less stress so you don't burn out. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Karen. So now it's time for the usual question assurance. And I already see some hands. I'm pretty sure go. It's a subject that hits home.
Yeah. Hi. Have you done any form of research versus free marketplace versus controlled workspace? I mean, heavily regulated workspace versus, you know, work until you basically collapse China style.
I personally haven't, but I researched a PhD thesis amongst quite a bit of other materials before coming here. And the workspace that's hierarchical and more regulated is where people can experience less stress rather than the more egalitarian workplace where you're expected to bear a lot more, you take a lot more risk. Be autonomous, and then we end up with the self-managing worker, like I explained earlier on, that is seen as a positive thing because you have all that autonomy, but in reality ends up creating a lot more stress, burnout, and in the end, depression.
How did you decide you were ready to go back to work?
How did you decide? I needed something to do. So a person needs something to do. And I thought, what is it that I could now do with my life? And I also needed the money, right? as we all do. I guess, I don't know, it was so natural for me to go back to work. The more the question was, what next? because I didn't want to carry on in the same kind of field anymore. And then you end up thinking, okay, what am I good at? What is my previous experience? And what would I like to do? And try and marry these three things up to then do a career pivot. So that's what I ended up doing, was pivoting back into ICT and creating a niche for myself in that. And now then I was calculating 40 more years of working life. You know, maybe there's a time for another pivot in 20 years from now.
Hello, thank you for the speech. How to learn to say no to your colleagues when they ask for help? Because you really want to help them. But sometimes when you go home and everyone is busy with some release testing or else, and you feel guilty. But actually, you need to go home, but at the same time, you feel guilty.
Yeah, the therapist I saw, Helena, she told me that the first thing people perceive from you is emotion. So delivering a decline or a negative message with compassion or with emotion is something that people pick up on first. And then they won't, you know, we reflect each other's emotions. So if you say, oh, bugger off, I don't have time for this, they will reflect this back at you and be pissed off. But it's more about being empathetical, I think. Empathy is the key word. So always when you speak to a colleague or anyone, actually, even within our family, emotion is the thing that always gets through first, and then the message will get through first. So I had to turn down something on Wednesday that people were counting on me for. And I did it over phone, because on an email it would have been quite rude and not very nice thing to do. And with the guilt thing as well, it's an emotion you have to let go of, because if you carry this in the back of your mind all the time, with all the unresolved tasks and all the stuff you want to do, all the clutter, the brain clutter, tires and stresses you out just as much. So in a way, you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't. But you need to learn to let go of the guilt and also all the stuff that you know, you need to do and help people with.
Yeah, there's one more.
Hi. I sometimes have the problem that people don't accept my no. You see, there are a lot of people telling me you have to learn to say no, but please not to me. don't work too hard on the hiring, except if I'm the hiring manager. Don't work too much on the sales, except if I'm the sales. Then that's important. How do you avoid getting your no worn down?
How do you avoid, sorry, your no turned down?
Yeah, worn down. You see, oh really, this is important, and so on and so forth, because that's what happens often to me.
Okay. I would say stand your ground. I've also been guilty of taking too much on, because people say, please do it. Then I say, I can't really do it. Then my message is maybe a bit vague. And I actually did a law course on top of my film education. And we had a special class there about how to come across in your physical language and in your body language as assertive and as somebody people will respect. So that's something you can train for, to learn with your body language and with the way you speak to somebody. So I recommend looking that up. A good TED talk on this topic is actually by Amy Cuddy. A lot of the people here will know about this talk. And she, have you heard of it? Yeah, so she does all these kind of body language, priming yourself up to say no and so forth. And it will come with time. So, you know, you can be in front of the mirror saying, I'm going to say no. And then somebody comes and hits you at completely the wrong moment. And you say no, and they won't accept it. Or, a situation ensues where you haven't asserted yourself. But the more you practice it, the easier it will become. So just keep saying no.
So now I have to say no, yeah?
Not to me. So I have a question about, do you have any recommendations or experiences with taking care of your colleagues? Because very, very often it can be difficult to, if you say to someone, it looks like you're very busy, can I help you with something? People will say, no, it's fine, because you get that kick of doing just another task and another task and another task. So what will you recommend to intervene on other people's behalf?
It, I guess it depends on your position as well and how your relationship is with that particular person. So if you're friendly, what my London boss used to do was take us for a coffee or tag along on a lunch break and then pick it up outside of the workspace when we were in our downtime and then go through the worry there and say, look, I can actually see that you're busy and you need more help. And not, do you want more help? But I'm in a position of authority, I will offer it to you, and you will accept it, and you will, you know, be rewarded with more time because I've offered you help. So there's probably, yeah, multiple things to take into account for. Also in my current company where we are at CGI, I can see the team lead, we have a lot of social events. So that's when you can really, you know, express things off your chest. And that's where often agreements are made to help each other as well. But the climate within a team has to be good enough all the time for people to be able to express these feelings. So as somebody who is a manager, it's imperative to make sure that that kind of climate within a team is upheld. And I would address these, as a manager, I would address these issues outside of the working place in a comfortable environment that I can see you need help and I will come and help you. And there will be some people who will just refusely, you know, they will just flat out refuse you and you can't force yourself on them. But being there and offering help multiple times will usually lead to them accepting it in the end. That's my experience anyway.
All right. So this will be the last one, all right? I'm still too kind. I need to learn how to say no, yeah?
I would like to ask how companies decide how much work is an employee supposed to do. For example, in the like 18th century, there was this guy like Taylor. He stood next to factory lines with stopwatches and he was like measuring employees and setting standards. So how is it done today and how it should be done?
To measure people's... actually supposed to be doing, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. That really depends on the industry, the company, etc. But within a tech company, for example, and it depends on your employment contract as well and your position, for example. So I don't get now anymore, I don't get paid for overtime, which is why I have to seriously get everything done within my normal working day. And when I was working in the UK, what we had was... This was actually horrible, right? When we worked from home, I used to work for the Health and Social Care Regulator of England and Wales. I was in their ICT department. And we had, when we worked from home, and if we'd been idle for 5 minutes, then a messenger thing would go red and my boss would see it, you know. But maybe I was reading a report and I had to seriously concentrate. But he would see that, oh, Karen's slacking. She's not working. So there is no right one single answer to that. How much you should be working depends on what your responsibilities are, what your contractual agreement is with your company, what position you hold, how much risk you've agreed to take on for the autonomy, remember, that you're supposedly given, and the industry you work in. Yeah?
All right.
Done? No more questions?
No more. Time
Thank
is
you
up.
Very much.
So thank you, Karen, for coming over here and sharing your story. This is a little goodie bag to keep you not so stressed. Yeah.